Honorable Speaker, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I congratulate Honorable Mangala Samaravira, our Finance Minister, for having introduced within a very, very short span of time a vote on account to cover the next few months until he is able to submit the budget for 2019. Having endured the 50 days of unnecessary crisis that was created by the unconstitutional actions of the important office bearers of institutions of this country, I do not want to go into names here, but we have been pushed into presenting about an account to cover all these follies. So in this situation, let me, while congratulating the Honorable Minister, also say that what we have got to look away is because, but we need to position ourselves in order, in the long term, to move away from foreign borrowing as much as possible by attracting non-debt creating foreign exchange inflows, especially through earnings from export of goods and services and foreign direct investments, by adopting a national policy conducive to achieving a sustainable current account deficit or a current account surplus in the balance of payments of this country. And this challenge is not an easy challenge for the Honorable Finance Minister. He is one of those people who have, since 1989, been in this house, have served this chamber for more than a quarter century, and is quite experienced in tackling the problems. But however, the enormity of his task in presenting a challenging budget for the next year, because next year happens to be an election year. That is the most difficult part. So everybody expects a sunshine budget, but I'm sure he will pull out a few rabbits out of his hat.
One or two.
He's a magician. He can be a magician. But we are all waiting to see how many rabbits he can pull out of his hat. Honorable Dasri Jayasekara is very, very silent. He is one of those people who is at the crossroads of political history in this country. He has been put into difficulty by all our national leaders. You see, I said, now the whole problem today what we are facing is the three national leaders want to ensure about their own political future. The Honorable Mahinda Rajapaksa wants the presidency abolished because he cannot contest it for the next time. Honorable Ranil Wickremesinghe is not a national leader who would engage in irrational political campaign. He's a very rational leader. He doesn't want to go on these sentimental, emotional, nationalistic bandwagons and then get into power. Because of that, he had paid a very heavy price. So he also feels, you know, in a national election, he had in fact pushed others in the front and have been in the driving seat, getting them to win the elections. You see, first he failed with General Sarath Fonseca, then thereafter, though we succeeded in bringing His Excellency the President to power, now with the recent happenings, that too has become a failure. So then he too has this problem. He wants the, perhaps the presidential election, presidential system abolished. Then, of course, President Maithripala Sirisena is in another dilemma. He started off saying that he will not contest for the second term. Halfway through, he entertained ideas of contesting it. First, he thought United National Party will accommodate him once again. Subsequently, he fell onto the lap of Honorable Mahinda Rajapaksa and perhaps expects him or expected him to nominate him for presidential candidacy. So all that, now this all, you see, we cannot tinker with the constitution in order to ensure the future of single people, single politician, however leading national figures they may be. We need to have a broad look at it, because this is a sacred document. You have to have an overall constitutional reform, and that's the challenge we have. Now, amidst this, the Honorable Mangala Samaravira has this problem of having to balance everything and produce a proper budget next year. Now, very, very briefly, Mr. Speaker, since I have limited time. Now, following the country's graduation as a lower middle-income economy in 2010, the availability of concessional financing began to decline rapidly as a percentage of total foreign debt. Concessional debt declined to 48.8% in 2015 from over 90% before 2007. The lower availability of concessional financing prompted the country to access the international capital markets by issuing international sovereign bonds. Since 2007, Sri Lanka has been active in the international capital market to meet its financing needs, which has made the country more open to international investors. This has also resulted in increased attention towards sovereign ratings. Now, what happened to the sovereign ratings recently? Now, we become subject to sovereign rating fluctuations due to our political instability. Now, these people who created the instability, who are now seated honorably as opposition members, must realize that the folly that you engaged in has resulted in a serious situation for the economy. Foreign direct investments have begun to decline. We were in a situation where, because we cannot depend on the sovereign borrowing anymore. What about state-owned enterprises? Now, I am in charge of one of the state-owned enterprises. Now, we have been encouraged to go and borrow directly.
Another 2 minutes more, Honorable Minister.
Mr. Speaker, now we have this serious situation. In the past few years, Mr. Speaker, financing requirements of the government have been met with a number of sources other than direct borrowing by the government. These include foreign direct borrowings of state-owned enterprises. In particular, in the recent years, debt levels of major non-financial public corporations have risen substantially. And by, now I'm having the figure in 2015, this amounted to 861 billion, 7.7% of the GDP. Large amounts of debt stock of state-owned enterprises also increased the current contingent liabilities of the government, aggravating the debt problem. Now, we have to take this into account. We have been pushed into this position. Now, to get out of this debt trap, we need to be a little more mature, right? But I'm sure, I have my confidence in the Honorable Finance Minister that he will look at all the issues in its proper perspective, and focusing on 2019 budget would try and give relief to the affected people. The safety net that we had to offer to the socially backward rural poor farmers, we cannot forget them. We need to address those issues. And we have been faced with serious natural disasters for the last few years. Floods, landslides, and the fluctuating weather patterns have had serious impact in the country's economy. So with all that, the Honourable Mangala Samaravira has managed to, within a very, very short span of time, been able to produce this water account. I'm sure his main challenge is to produce the budget for 2019. I hope he would look at the northern and eastern provinces in particular. The Honourable Prime Minister has proposed to set up a separate commission, separate development commission for both northern and eastern provinces, where we will be able to produce substantially productive development programs in those areas, so that the issues pertaining to unemployment, issues pertaining to livelihood in the affected areas will be properly addressed.
Time is over, Honourable Minister.
Mr. Speaker, with those words, I conclude my speech.
Thank you.